Hello again, welcome back. This video talks about secrets. And the reason I'm doing this video is because there are millions around the world who believe that Freemasonry is a secret society. And whether or not it is, and I'm going to go into the meaning of that, what that might mean in due course. Whether or not it is, the notion of secret society has been, it has very negative connotations, especially to those outside of the fraternity or outside of the organization. And I think only naturally that's the case to be seen in negative light because people don't like to not be in the know. Or what we could say is people like to know things, especially secrets, especially things that the majority of people don't know. Now, if you're part of the majority of those that don't know, then you want to know. If you're part of a group that hold information, who know something, then it's human nature to want to hold on to that information, not tell all and sundry. That's a very human concept and notion about secret holding. That's not, in my view, what Masonry is about at all. And I'm going to go into why not. And I'm going to talk about a piece of ritual where the word secret comes up. I'm going to talk about the meaning of this, the word secret and the etymology and what I think the phrase secret society really means, why secrets have been mentioned in Masonry and what that is referring to. So without further ado, I'm just going to read to you part of the solemn obligation that features in the first degree ceremony. Which I'm fully aware that there are many around the world who will be saying, I'm in breach of my solemn obligation by even reading this out. Well, I'm going to explain why that's not the case. So, solemn obligation is, if for those who don't know, is an obligation that a candidate who is undergoing his first degree ceremony and second degree and third degree, and no doubt in every other degree thereafter that one goes through, they give some obligation, and it's solemn because it's meant to be between you and your divine creator. It's something that's so personal and deep. It's a covenant that you make with your higher nature. And it goes like this: I, and I'll use my name, Ben Sion, in the presence of the great architect of the universe and of this worthy and warranted lodge of free and accepted Masons, regularly assembled and properly dedicated of my own free will and accord, do hereby and hereon solemnly promise and swear that I will always hail, conceal, and never reveal any part or parts of the secrets or mysteries of or belonging to free and accepted Masons in Masonry, which may heretofore have been known by me, or shall now or at any future time become communicated to me, unless it be to a true and lawful brother, and not even to him until after due trial, strict examination, or sure information from a well-known brother that he is worthy of that confidence, or in the body of a just, perfect, and regular lodge of accepted Masons. Now, I'm going to stop there. It goes on a bit further, but I'm going to stop there for now. I don't believe that what it's saying in this passage is you are not to communicate what you see in the ritual. I don't believe it's saying that at all. I don't believe that the word secrets or mysteries refer to what one discovers within a ceremony. I also don't believe that it has any bearing or any relationship to any passwords or past grips, handshakes, whatever you want to call them. I don't believe it has any bearing on that. I don't believe it's right to communicate passwords and past grips for another reason, which I'll go into in this video as well. But in relation to this particular point, secrets or mysteries here, I think, are relating, they're referring to what's within the individual Mason. And I'm going to prove it to you. So it says here, solemnly promise and swear that I will always hail, conceal, and never reveal any part or parts of the secrets or mysteries of or belonging to free and accepted Masons in Masonry, which may heretofore have been known by me, or shall now, or at any future time, become communicated to me. Well, let's just pause this. Remember that this is a piece of ritual which is delivered to a candidate in the first degree, and they're not meant to have been aware of this prior to the entering into the lodge room. They're not meant to have been aware of anything that happens in the lodge ceremony before they go into that lodge room. Excuse me. So why would it say the words, which may heretofore have been known by me? Think about this. It can't be referring to anything that the ritual is saying, because prior to this, you're not meant to have known it. So it's got to be relating, in my view, to something which is revealed within an individual Mason. And I'll go over the words again. Solemnly promise and swear that I will always hail, conceal, and never reveal any part or parts of the secrets or mysteries of or belonging to free and accepted Masons in Masonry. So it's not the secrets or mysteries of Masonry. It's not the secrets or mysteries belonging to Masonry. It's the secrets or mysteries of or belonging to free and accepted Masons. I'll put that into context. Let's say, for instance, a Mason comes up to me and says, Ben, I've found a wonderful secret relating to the square. Let me share it with you. Okay, I'm willing to hear it. If he tells me this, then what it's saying here, that I will always hail, conceal, and never reveal any part or parts of the secrets or mysteries of or belonging to free and accepted Masons in Masonry, which may heretofore have been known by me. So let's just, I'm going to go through this. If he says to me, Ben, I've just found a secret belonging to the square, and he tells me what he's discovered. Now, I can guarantee whatever one has discovered, there is a deeper meaning below that, and there'll be a deeper meaning below that, and a deeper meaning below that. But whatever level I'm on in respect of this individual, I have a duty not to tell that individual what is below that. I also have a duty not to go too far in relation to that person's interpretation. The most that I will do, and that I should do as a Mason, is encourage that Mason, or encourage that person, I should say, to let that germinate, let that see what happens, and let that just contemplate that. Just let that settle within one's consciousness and see what else one can find. Because with each symbol and piece of allegory and ritual, looking into it, it's like opening a portal to a whole new universe. So taking, for instance, an example of the square, you can look at the square and see that it's an angle of 90 degrees. And then you can look deeper and say, oh, well, the opposite of Mason put it against the stone to measure its uprightness, and it's how level the base is. Okay, so the uprights and horizontals, verticals and horizontals. Fine. Okay, then you can look deeper. It's an angle of 90 degrees, or the fourth part of a circle. And you keep going and going and going until you have entered into this realm quite apart from it just being a symbol in a lodge room. You have entered into a completely new reality in respect of that particular symbol. It's like if anyone's watched or read the books, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, where the children, they go into the wardrobe, they open the door at the back of the wardrobe and enter into Narnia, a completely different realm. It's like that with every symbol. So going back to this piece of ritual, solemnly promise and swear that I will always hail, conceal, and never reveal any part or parts of the secrets or mysteries of or belonging to free and accepted Masons in Masonry, which may heretofore have been known by me, or shall now, or at any future time, become communicated to me. Now, unless it be to a true and lawful brother, and not even to him until after due trial or strict examination, or sure information from a well-known brother that he is worthy of that confidence. So if you're going to reveal something that someone has imparted to you, to another, or at least reveal, let's just say you have something deeper to reveal back to that individual, you have to be pretty sure, you have to be very sure that they're ready to receive it, that they're on that level that is ready for that communication. So you have a duty when you're in receipt of some information. But flip this on its head. What about if you are the one who have found a secret? So I solemnly promise and swear that I will always hail, conceal, and never reveal any part or parts of the secrets or mysteries of or belonging to free and accepted Masons in Masonry. Well, you've now become one by virtue of that ceremony. So you have to put yourself in that category. So what if you discover something? Are you now under an obligation not to communicate that to someone else unless you know that they are of a certain level who are ready to receive that communication? I think the answer must be yes. But I think I must caveat this with the following. No matter what you give in terms of your own interpretation of a symbol, remember that that is unique to you and it will have particular meaning to you. Every individual sees things in their own unique way. So, for instance, I, as an author, I initially struggled with the notion as to whether I should actually be writing down my interpretations of Masonry or whether I should just leave it to the individual to find for themselves. And I was torn for quite a while, actually, probably for about a year before I released the book. I eventually decided to release it for the following reason. Whenever one can find some information, let's say you've come upon a discovery about a particular symbol and it's resonating so much with you, you feel you've got to tell someone about it. And let's just say you tell three people. One of them's resonating on your level, the other two are not. The other two are, let's say, they're way below your level of resonance. The one who's resonating on your level will get it. Or they've already seen it, but they'll get it. They'll know what you're referring to. The other two will not understand it, and most likely their ego will kick in and completely dismiss what you have said. They'll dismiss this gift of information, and they'll refer to what they believe is the truth, because they're looking at reality like that, not like that. If you're on a higher level, your vision is like that. Whereas someone on a low level, their vision is more angular. It's closed. So they're not open to receiving. So even if you do communicate this to another, if they're not ready to receive, then they will dismiss this. Again, I'm going to caveat that, depending on the information that you're going to give, if they're not ready to receive, they can misinterpret the information, and that's always a dangerous thing. So, you know, there's a hell of a lot of responsibility that one has to have and use. They have to act responsibly when they have discovered some information. Now, the word secret or mystery in this ritual and in relation to Masonry itself, it's not referring, in my view, as I've said before, to what they have found in the ritual, what they found in the ceremony. There are passwords and passcripts communicated to each individual candidate on each degree. So a password and a passcript is communicated to a candidate to enter into that next step, that next stage. And I would always call it an illusory next stage, but I'm going way too deep there for this video. The whole notion stems back to in ancient times, when those that were involved in sort of guild work, Freemasonry, stonemasonry, in an operative sense, the way that one would communicate would be through certain gestures and symbols. And if it was common in that time that those of a certain profession would not have the ability to read or write, they would be entrusted with a particular handshake that would be communicated to them when they reach a particular level. And this all stems to what they would be given by way of payment, their wages, as a result of their work. So let's just say you've got a master who has been through all those three major stages, who is giving the wages to those who are subordinate to him. Then let's say they've got an initiate, an entered apprentice, that's the first level, who's been given a particular handshake, particular grip. Well, that entered apprentice will give the grip corresponding with his level of apprenticeship to the master. The master will immediately know what level that person's on and what wage will be attributed to that level. Similarly, a fellow craft, which is the next level up, will be given a different pass script. That pass script will be communicated to the master, and the master will give the fellow craft his dues corresponding with his level. So the master will know what level they're at. It would be absolutely forbidden for the fellow craft to communicate the pass script that he's been given to the entered apprentice who's not been given it yet. And likewise, it would be wrong for the master mason to communicate that pass script to the fellow craft or to the entered apprentice, because they are being given, there would be, if they were to communicate that pass script, they'd be given a benefit that they have not earned. It's about working one's way up. It's about earning one's dues. You must earn for the right to receive. So I think that must be where it comes from. And I'm not about to give any of those particular aspects of the ritual in these videos, because I don't feel it's right to. It's like, I don't want to ruin an experience for an individual. But in relation to secrets, that's not what they are. I don't believe that is what this is referring to. The etymology of the word secret is, it comes from Latin, and it's cesenere, if I pronounce that right. And then it's the word secretus comes from there. But cesenere is, ser is apart, cernere is sift. So if it's like sifting apart from, let's just say you've got sand and you've got a colander, and you're sifting the sand through the colander, and within the sand you've got certain gems. That's what it's like. Now, the word secretion is very closely connected with the word secret. Secret comes, secretion comes from the word secret. Secretion means to draw from, to secrete. And in my view, that's what the Mason, the Mason engaged with this learning and this practicing Masonry in a real sense, to speculate upon the ritual and to draw from such speculation certain meanings that will resonate within. Now, one would encourage anyone who actually finds such information to hold it within and let that germinate, as I've said before. I'm in two minds whether it would be better to discover information oneself, so happen upon a secret, so secrete it for yourself, or to be imparted something that resonates on a particular level. They both have a different flavor, but one can't deny that no matter how you've come upon it, whether you've found it yourself or whether you've been given it, once it resonates, it becomes yours. It's very special. And for me, that's what secret is. It's something drawn from a meaning. and kept hidden within you so that you can then let it sort of permeate through your being. So, and also just before I tidy this up, secretary, which is a secretary is, you know, arguably no logical function without a secretary. The word secretary comes from the word secret. It's the one who is in charge of communication. It's the one that is there to secrete from the various members, whether they're coming to the meeting or not, to secrete from them their apologies or their signification that they're actually coming to the meeting. Also about meals and things like that. So again, it comes from the same meaning. And to wrap this up, the secret society that is referred to about the craft, I appreciate there are many in the fraternity that go, it's not a secret society, it's a society with secrets. Well, I don't agree with either of these two notions. I think the secret society is the one that is within the heart of every individual. So in respect of Freemasonry, it's his own secret society that this is referring to, not in a macro sense, in a micro sense. So within the heart of every Freemason is his own secret society. Well, look, thank you very much for listening and for indulging me and putting up with my incessant ramblings about certain notions of Freemasonry. I hope you're enjoying these videos. I wouldn't do it if the feedback I'm getting would be negative. Please do put your comments in the comments section. Let me know what you think of these videos and if you've got any questions or any insightful points. I would love to hear from you. If you've liked the video, please do press the like button at the bottom, wherever it will be. I think it's over there. And please subscribe if you haven't already done so, if you want to see what more is coming from this channel. And also, if you want to get any alerts, regular alerts as to any new videos coming, just ding the bell and you'll be getting regular alerts. All right, well, thank you very much, and I'll see you in the next video.